Hey everyone, along with the last week, today we are talking about continuously this mechanical transduction pathway. So for your memory, I will put this slide again. So from your any mechanical stress or electrical stimulation or physical stress, even in calcium uptake, this low AGDP and GTP, they are changed, low AGDP to change to GTP, and then they can bind to cell membrane for action. Which is this low GTP can activate low ROCK kinase, which is called ROCK. And then this ROCK kinase can make this myosin light chain phosphorylation for active non-muscle myosin 2. Because of this myosin light chain phosphorylation, this is a net point between head and then heavy chain of non-muscle myosin 2. So this phosphorylation can make actin myosin interaction, which means the myosin non-muscle myosin 2 can bind to actin, and then actin myosin contraction and cell area and motility and even in certain gene expression can occur. So along with this pathway, this MLCK phosphorylation, so myosin light chain kinase, MLCK is myosin light chain kinase, and then when they are phosphorylated, they can activate a myosin light chain phosphorylation. Okay, so this myosin light kinase, when they are phosphorylated with calcium, they can activate non-muscle myosin 2. But in another contractory pathway, myosin light chain phosphatase, which remove the phosphorylation from the myosin light chain, so they can deactivate this myosin light chain phosphorylation. So myosin light chain phosphorylation can be controlled by ROCK in one way, positively. For myosin light kinase, positively. For MLC phosphatase, negatively. So this ROCK also, they can affect the myosin light chain phosphatase phosphorylation for inactivation. So sometimes phosphorylation can make the signal happen. Sometimes they inhibit the activation. So it depends on the context-dependent manner they can occur. And then as a type of the low GTPase, which is ROCK1 and low AGTP, these are sometimes deactivate themselves, sometimes they can synergetically activate them, but mostly this ROCK1 is involved in migration, but this low AGTP is more linking to some spreading or anchoring in certain site, so they negatively affect each other. Cause when the cell might want to migrate, they have to decrease some focalization or actin filament, and then they are more easy to migrate. So here, how the myosin light chain is regulated by myosin light kinase. Myosin light kinase, when they are phosphorylated, this Y464 and Y471 site by the tyrosine kinase, and then this calcium and calmodulin complex occur, this myosin light kinase can myosin light chain phosphorylation in this site, and then they are making stroke of the myosin domain and then actin filament. But in another pathway, in another way, myosin light chain phosphatase remove this phosphorylation of serine group, and then myosin light chain can be inactivated. But this myosin light chain phosphatase also can be controlled by ROCK. Yeah. And then when they are phosphorylated, this is inactive form. So this low GTP, class 1 low GTP, RAG 1 series 42 is mostly involved in migration, but this low GTP itself, this is more making stress fiber. So when cell want to migrate, they turn on this RAG 1 series 42, and then they deassemble the actin and then myosin actin interaction, and then less focal adhesion complex for its accelerated migration. But when cell feel, okay, I'm happy, I want to spread and I want to be here, and then they are using, they are turn on this low GTP, low kinase, and then more stress fiber, inducing cell contraction, and then more focal adhesion complex. Here, the TALEN is number one protein to link beta integrin intracellular domain to the another focal adhesion complex plus actin, and then vinculin and other adhesion complex is involved. So in each pathway, we can find many inhibitor like blebbistatin. Today I'm going to talk about the mechanism. They involve in this actin myosin interaction, so they are losing the cell contraction. In this LAT-A and Cyto-D, they depolymerize the actin. When there is no actin, you know, no stress fiber formation, and then no stress is transmitted. And ML7, they inhibit this MLCK postulation, and then make them deactivate the numbers machine too. And then why they control ROCK kinase inhibit C3 component of the botox, they inhibit this low AGTP. And then this NSH2, they inhibit this ROCK1. When ROCK1 is deactivate this low GTP, NSH somehow they can activate low AGTP by via inhibition of ROCK1. So sometimes they are using this NSH to activate this ROCK kinase. And then other like to inhibit calcium, between red, CSA is, yeah, CSA and BAPTA AM can be involved. And then as activator is not that much, but LPA, through this LPA receptor, they activate the low GTP. So along with the last week, we are starting this ectomyosin contraction. So actin, when we see in detail, the actin is forming like that. Actin monomer, they are polymerized as a two chain. And then tropomyosin, this is some filament structure. And then tropomyosin and troponin complex are involved. And then initially, they cover this myosin binding site, which means this is inactive form. But in the presence of calcium, this calcium can bind troponin complex. This filament, tropomyosin filament, shift, and then to expose myosin binding site. And then what will happen? From non-muscle myosin to head, they can bind to myosin binding site. Okay, this describes why calcium is involved to make the actin myosin contraction. Okay, cause this tropomyosin should be exposed and should be shifted to expose myosin binding site. And then from this mechanism, this is a tropomyosin. Is normally tropomyosin 2.1. This is normal status. In the normal status, they are making contraction unit, contraction power, and then contraction power means they cell can sense the rigidity, stiffness of the ECM. A normal cell or untransformed cell, they can sense the rigidity by myosin 2A, cause myosin contraction is the motor to feel the ECM stiffness. So in the soft, when they feel soft, cell easy to be dead. And then, but when they feel hard, oh, they feel like this land, they can land the substrate, that they can spread, so they can make them survive for the adherent cell. Okay, so when you culture, actually this study is based on the less adherent, and less adherent ECM. So, but in case of this soft, also when we remove this TPM 2.1, this green one, and then less myosin 2A, even their culture on soft, we can make the cells survive. But when you see this on the right side, this normal TPM 2.1 is displaced by the TPM 3.1. TPM 3.1 is detected in cancer cell or transformed cell. In this case, this transformed cell cannot sense the rigidity because they are malfunctioning of the myosin 2. So even they are culturing on the soft or hard, all this cell can make survive because this troponin myosin 3.1, they always activate the myosin. So cell feel like whether they are landing soft or hard substrate, they feel, oh, I feel very good stress, so I can make them survive, I can spread. So either way, they can survive. So if you are interested about this paper, yeah, this paper is published in Nature Material 2014 or 15. So I'm going to share it. And then let's understand how the actin and non-myosin myosin interaction happen for making power stroke. So when you start from this here, this non-myosin myosin to this is the light chain, heavy chain tail and head domain, they are having ADP. ADP means 2 phosphorylation with adenosine. And then when they make some power stroke, they release ADP and 1 inorganic phosphate group. And then they are in the lag phase. Okay? As a lag phase. So after making one stroke in the lag phase, and then ATP newly bind, T is mean ATP, and then they are recovered, which means they are ready for doing something. And then after ATP is phosphorylation, hydrolysis means ATP convert to ADP plus inorganic phosphate group, even though they are not written here, but I will show you later again. So ADP and P is in here, head domain. And then they are prone to attach this myosin binding site of actin, and then they are binding and then making power stroke. Okay, when you look at this head domain, actin binding crypt can bind the actin, and then ADP P analog here, and then root of neck means here, maybe below this root of neck is non-myosin myosin light chain. And then blepharostatin, they are docking this ADPP analog nearby. And then what will happen when they are docking here, the ADP and P, they cannot be released. And then because of this docking to near actin binding cleft, physically this head cannot attach to actin. So the mechanism two way inhibit the actin myosin, actin, head, and then myosin light, myosin head interaction is inhibited by blepharostatin as well. ADP P analog cannot be, even they are attaching, they cannot be released. So they cannot make the stroke. So this is meaning of the blepharostatin and mechanism of action of blepharostatin for inhibiting myosin actin contraction. So again, here, in case of actin monomer, they should be polymerized to make F-actin, but this cyto-D, sphingolipid A, and mycolipid B, they inhibit this actin polymerization. When there is no actin, there is no way to make actin contraction because there is no actin. But even in the presence of F-actin, this myosin heavy chain and this, maybe this yellow one is light chain, and this is the head. In case of blepharostatin, they affect the head and then inhibit some docking as well as ADP and then phospho analog release. And in case of this rock and MLC phosphatase and then MLC, this myosin light chain, when you highlight this orange one, this is myosin light chain, and then rock can make myosin light chain phosphorylation for having action of affecting and normal myosin to contraction. So here this picture, they didn't highlight the molecular level of the myosin light chain, but maybe this way, when they are making power stroke, this myosin light chain should be phosphorylated, and then they are making power stroke. So because of this myosin light chain phosphorylation and their contraction of affecting and number of myosin 2, some various cell behave occur. So in detail, here, we can start from here, okay? So initially, they have ATP, and then this head, light chain, head and heavy chain, right? This head, after binding this ATP, they shift to the right, left to right. This means recovery stroke. Recovery means two initial status. And then the ATP is ATP hydrolyzed, and then ADP to phosphorylate 1,2, yellow one, and then violet color, phosphate analog, here, okay? And then while they're, and then they are ready for attaching, docking to myosin site, binding site of actin. So from here, as soon as ATP hydrolysis, they are ready for binding actin, and then they release ADP and phospho analog, then power stroke. And this right way convert to the left. Okay, so like your wrist movement, when you do some badminton or some smash, they have to go right to left. Okay, and then using this stroke, affectin can be moved to the left way, and then they are released and they are in the leg phase, and then after binding the ATP, they are deattached, and then ready, and then they are going to recovery stroke. Okay, so when you do exercise heavily, you feel like I don't have any power, which means I don't have any ATP in your muscle. So they are in the leg phase, like this. But when you consume some chocolate or some sugar, immediately the ATP is provided to the muscle, and then this myosin light, myosin, number of myosin 2 can be recovered from the ATP. Okay, so sometimes when you see some athletic in professional game during the break, they are consuming some sugar drink or some other chocolate. This is the why they have to feed the high ATP ingredient. So in another way, yeah, similarly, number one, affecting here, and then this is normal myosin 2, and then this is light chain, and then head, normal myosin to head. Site of ATP binding, this is recover stroke, using this term. And then after ATP hydrolysis, ADP and phosphoanalog, they can make it, and then they shift to like this. And then they are ready for docking to affectin. And then while they are releasing postphanalog and ADP, they can stroke, move the affectin. And then as soon as when they have many ATP, immediately they binding to ATP site for having recovery stroke. So from this manner, affectin, they cannot move by themselves, only with the help of non-muscle myosin 2, and then ATP-ADP conversion, they can be moved. So in another way, yeah, this is more in detail, and then show the relation between non-muscle myosin 2 and affectin and their myosin 2 binding site. Number one, binding of myosin to actin. After ATP hydrolysis, phosphoanalog ADP, and then they are ready for binding this black dot. And then actually the phospho inorganic phosphate, they are first released. And then this ADP can make the affectin and numbers minus 2 stroke, power stroke. Okay, and then actin gets pulled toward middle of the sarcomere. Actually, this is getting from the muscle tissue, but this same thing happened in your all kind of cell. So ADP is released, and then the this numbers minus 2 can be in the rigor status, means myosin in low energy form. Even they are attaching, they cannot make any power. But new ATP bind to myosin head, and then their energy is turning on again. And then unbinding of myosin of actin, and then ATP, and then they are making some recovery stroke, and then ATP hydrolysis, PI-ADP, and then they are ready for cocking to myosin head side. Because PI ADP can make this non-muscle myosin to our high energy form. Okay. So same manner. So they depict in many different format, but all kind of schematic have one message. Yeah. Myosin heavy domain, turn on state, and then they are doing like that. So on state, they can shift each other. So for this, ATP should be hydrolysis, and then ADP and PI should be involved. So number five, partially I described the role of the calcium in mechanical transduction. But when I collect them in one slide, this is normal, yeah, mechanical transduction pathway. This low A GDP also, inactive form, when they are in the cell membrane or detached, inactive form. But because of this exchange factor, low A have, when they have GTP, they are firmly involved in this cell membrane in active form. They are turned off from this GAP. When this low HTP turning on, low kinase ROCK turn on. This ROCK turn on, myosin light chain, the neck is phosphorylated, and then myosin light chain phosphorylated, they are docking to affecting and then making contraction. But this MLC phosphatase active form, they remove phosphorylation, turn on. And this MLC kinase, they are accelerating MLC phosphorylation. Okay. When this MLCK kinase is activated, they need calcium and calmodulin complex. So anyhow, they need some this calcium from the extracellular level through this calcium mediated channel or some piezo channel. When they are more calcium, maybe they have more power to bind the calmodulin and calcium and then make this MHK activation more. Or from their inside of ER or any kind of intracellular organelle, also they can release this calcium. So from this pathway, I want to highlight the role of the calcium to make cell contraction, stress fiber, focal adhesion, migration, or cytokinase, or gene suppression level as well. So in detail, here, when they actin myosin contraction, myosin light chain should be phosphorylated. This myosin means myosin light chain. When the myosin light chain is phosphorylated, this MHK, with the help of the ATP, ATP is 3-phosphate, they turn to 2-phosphate, and then 1-phosphate group shift to the myosin light chain. And then myosin light chain, when they combine with actin, this they can make ectomyosin phosphorylate form after docking between these two. And then, as we show last slide, with the help of ATP and hydrolysis, ADP and PI is released, and then we can make cell stroke. While they're doing this myosin light chain phosphorylation, calcium cytoplasm, CYT cytoplasm level, when they high, this calcium and calmodulin complex is more formed, and then they are essential for MHCK activation. Okay? And then when they have many calcium level, also in another way, this ROCK kinase, they are involved in MHC phosphatase inhibition, right? So in one way, calcium can make MHCK activation. In another way, through this ROCK kinase, MHC phosphatase inhibition. So through these two mechanisms, MHC phosphorylation is accelerated. And then in this context, they are making this blood vessel contraction, or in from the cell level, actin stress fiber more formation, or they are making power more. And then this calcium also, they should be combined to a troponin complex and shift to the tropomyosin filament to this empty site to expose myosin binding site. Okay. And then from the extracellular level, the integrin is a receptor, one of the receptor, same as the cell any other kind of receptor, cross-foot receptor, receptor trypsin kinase or other kind of receptor. This one receptor, especially sensing the ECM component, right? In active form, they are bending like that. Normally, bending means somehow feel activation, but in case of integrin, bending means inactivation, closed. And then when you see the inside of the integrin, this sharpin and ACAP1, they are binding. This is deactivation form. But when they're activated, this bending should be unbended. They make them straight. When they're straight, from this alpha and beta integrin, they co-signal, co-dock the ligand, ECM. While they are binding this ligand, kindly and talin, majorly talin, is involved, and then they can make more focal adhesion, integrin complex, more integrin cluster, and then more affecting. So in case of activation, when you see the intracellular level, catalin, kindlin, and tetraspanin, you can see. So when you see many sharpin and AK1, which means integrin is not activated. So when you want to say my material can make the cell more integrin activation, you have to see decrease of AK1, increase of talin and kindlin. Okay, simply. And then, when you see this close type, this integrin is very close to each other. But when they are activation from single integrin set, their size is more larger than this one. And then, this larger integrin, they are more cluster. And then, this more cluster, we can see by ICC, confocal or microscope, as a dot. Oh. Talin expression or integrin expression. So from this outside to inside signaling, focal and complex and mechanical transduction can occur. So we can say talin. So when you want to check the focal adhesion complex, so first choice of the focal adhesion complex is talin, should be talin. Talin. They always bind to, for initially bind to the intracellular domain of the beta integrin. As you see, alpha integrin, they didn't attach to the affected or focused complex. Only beta integrin intracellular domain, they can be physically involved. And then alpha beta integrin co-sense the ECM component like this. Yeah, they are near neighbor. Yeah. Fill the ECM component. So close integrin bent, low affinity, extended, high affinity, alpha beta subunit. Here, small gap, larger gap. Okay. And talin always involved, and then, so. In here, this context, they are making inside-out signaling and outside-in signaling. Okay, when you look at outside-in signaling first, after ligand binding, open, extended, and high affinity from this fibronectin, collagen, laminin, or tannin C, which we are usually utilized for coating the ECM or your substrate dish. So this component can be felt by the alpha and beta integrin, and this causes outside-in signaling, and then they are making focal adhesion complex, and then ROCK, AKT, and ERK pathway can turn on. And then sometimes, from the inside of signaling, without any ligand, sometimes cell they need for activating this alpha and beta integrin. Also, that can happen. So from inside of signaling, somehow they can make them straight to sense the extracellular level. So like this, this is some integrin, alpha and beta, and collagen, and then this is talin. Very long and large compared to other vinculin and FAK and other complex, right? So that's why people look at more detail in talin here. And then kindlin, is attached to the beta integrin like this. So while this integrin formed and deep unformed, when they are activated, calcium, extracellular calcium level is also needed. Okay. So extracellular calcium is essential factor to make the integrin unbanded, means for activation. Okay? When they're activation, they are more easy to fill the ECM. And then this lacks intracellular domain also separated. So in case of calcium, they can play a role in inside through this ectocytokine organization, low GT page or some cluster. But in another way, from the extracellular level, also calcium is essential for making this integrin activation. So for utilizing this extracellular calcium level, we are using EDTA, trypsin, for detaching the cell, right? From the EDTA trypsin, EDTA acts as a methylchelator, which is added to trypsin solution to enhance activity. How? ADT is added to remove the calcium and magnesium from the cell surface, which means extracellular level, which allows trypsin to hydrolyze specific peptide bond to link integrin to ECM. So the principal reason of using the EDTA along with trypsin is to remove cell-to-cell adhesion. But that's why EDTA is used for some time to inactivate the integrin. Here, the example of the inactivation of assay using EDTA, pre-osteoblast cell treated, pre-treated 5 mmol EDTA for 10 minutes before cell seeding, cell-free or serum-containing environment, and then cell adhesion assay was performed for 3 hours. And then live and dead staining done. Let's see, when you only look at this RGD, this normal ECM, RGD can be detected in collagen, fibronectin, and when the cell secrete fibronectin to the your cell culture dish, definitely the cell sense the RGD. So without EDTA, the cell form well. But from the EDTA pre-treatment, 10 minutes, cell adhesion significantly decreased in terms of cell area and cell density, right? But here, this Nature paper, they making another polymer, DMCO. But this DMCO have another mechanism to attach the cell on the ECM. So in the presence of EDTA, somehow they can maintain, which means this material having another mechanism to attach the cell on the substrate, not through the integrin binding in the presence of FBS. And then without FBS, also already RGD coated substrate or this DMCO substrate, in case of RGD, very severely damaged the cell adhesion. So here they depict it like this. When you see serum free, for easy understanding, this cell actually they can have integrin binding mechanism and the oligosaccharide binding mechanism, right? Actually they have two. So in normal condition, RGD surface and minus EDTA, mostly integrin binding is occurring. Integrin is a binding occurring with help of calcium. But there's no need to oligosaccharide binding. But using the EDTA, calcium chelated, the integrin should not be unbanded, not open, not straight, so they are detached. So severely impair the cell adhesion. But in case of this special surface, they are involved in oligosaccharide binding to the cell because they have already have this DMCO polymer. Somehow they have good affinity to oligosaccharide of cell membrane. In the presence of the FBS, similar manner, this chicken leg is FBS binding, but this DM surface, special surface, in the presence of EDTA also, this oligosaccharide binding can occur. So maybe most of your material, they are majorly involved in integrin ECM binding. So to prove the EDTA and integrin is really needed to for your phenomenon, you can use this EDTA pre-treatment or just co-treatment. Especially when you stretch your cell or from the extracellular level using some microparticle, how this extracellular force can affect the cell fate, you can use the EDTA and then you can inhibit certain point the integrin ECM binding. So you can decrease the integrin ECM binding, and then to prove how ECM integrin binding is important for your mechanism, for your cell behavior. So yeah, using this context, maybe you can understand this is much better than before. So for our exam, maybe you exactly write down this one page is enough. Okay, you exactly try to memorize this one page, and then this all involved in this using also this inhibitor or activator, and then it's not easy to memorize it first, but once you memorize it, you can understand better the all kind of mechanical transduction paper. Maybe this is, you don't need to make them, you don't need to memorize it. Just conceptually you can understand this one. I only want you two guys to write down this and this inhibitor and activator, not these two. Okay? And then why is the application? So, okay, after memorizing this whole mechanical transduction pathway or inhibitor activator, anyhow, you have to utilize it, right? So in any content, in case of smooth muscle contraction or relaxation, maybe you have to do certain, you have to depict this kind of schematic images. When you see this one, they are using this titanium surface honeycomb structure. Honeycomb means like this round shape. And then they culture the macrophage. And then check their M1 and M2 polarization. So from their study, they summarize like this. Maybe they have to check which kind of integrin is involved. Okay? So well, they check alpha, beta 2 integrin, ICC, confirm this integrin, and then they also check paxilin, talin, vinculin, SRC, gene suppression level or protein level, ICC or Western blot. And then definitely the actin and focal adhesion complex are linking together. And then this RAG1 CD42 RhoA, this is what? This is low GTPase family, right? Small low GTPase family, they are involved in cytoskeletal rearrangement, sometimes polypodia formation. This one, they activate RAG kinase. It's RAG kinase. When they activate it, M2 is more macrophage activation, more enhanced. But this RAG signaling is inactivated, more M1. So maybe in any time when you do some study, you have to imagine this kind of schematic images. So maybe if you do ICC for integrin, you are involved here. Okay, this integrin is involved. Next, which kind of focal adhesion complex can be involved? As a major player, you can check talin, and then only talin is, you can put in Thailand here. But from any from kind of qPCR or RNA sequencing, when you see increase of this complex, also you can put this name here. And then for checking this kind of pathway, you have to do some inhibition study using Y and ML7 or any kind of things. Or from the RNA sequencing data, this small GTPase are enhanced in gene expression level. Somehow you can also depict like that. And then how this integrin can activate the M2 or M1, you have to see finer outcome in gene expression level as well as Western blood protein level. In any time, when you do any experiment, you always think about how you collect your data in one images. So like this also, when this guy can use telide low and high stiffness, in high stiffness, they are more straight. Low stiffness, deformed. High stiffness, more integrin. Definitely they check by the ICC or Western blood. More integrin, less integrin. And then Tallinn Fog Pactolin P130 Cas, when you want to draw this kind of protein in specifically, you have to check at least once from qPCR, ICC, Western blood. Okay? But sometimes when this involvement is very well known from other literature, in many times, sometimes without the experiment you can also depict this complex. But most of the time I suggest better to check at least once by ICC, qPCR, and any kind of experiment. And then how this actin is involved, okay? From low GTPase and YAPTAS coincide and then activation. But here low GTPase when they are inhibited and then YAPTAS is postulate and destruction. So this may be laminin and actin is interaction. Also here they can check. After checking how laminin of nuclear membrane can anchor this affecting, this is more anchored, but not anchored. Also, this ulcer, they should check this interaction. And then this may be YAPTAS, YAPTAS postulation, maybe this guy already checked by Western blood or ICC. And then how they form this low GTPase involvement for activation YAP, maybe they are using, somehow they are using blepharostatin or some Y to inactivate low GTPase from the high stiffness, and then prove this when they inactivate this low GTPase, YAPTAS can be destructed. So in detail, you can refer this paper. So this is from the Nature, how this stiffness can be involved. And then in molecular level, in terms of YAPTAS. So here, this is all high stiffness. In high stiffness, YAPTAS nuclear localization is enhanced in control, right? Almost 100%. But in case of C3, RAD-A treated, but they are going down, but not NST and Nocodazole. Nocodazole is what? Tubulin depolymerization, which means tubulin is not involved in this stiffness induced YAPTAS nuclear localization. NSCC is what? NSCC is ROCK1 inhibitor. ROCK1 somehow is not involved. But C3 RAD-A, C3 is low GTPase inhibitor. Why? RAD-A is what? Actin polymerase inhibitor. They are involved. Okay? Also, this Y also show inhibition, and BLEB also inhibited, right? So here, what they check? C3 upstream, RAD-A most downstream. And then next, Y in the middle, BLEB in the middle. So they check this C3, Y, BLEB, RAD-A to prove this pathway. Okay? So let's imagine when tilt on the Radha day going down, but Plevi not going down, which means somehow when acting is very important for your mechanism, but not through the ectomyosin interaction. Theoretically, actually, but not many phenomenon is like that. Maybe Plevi statin and actin polymerization, they are heavily involved, but theoretically, Radha treated going down, but Plevi statin maintained, which means somehow this actin polymerization is important for your mechanism, but not through this ectomyosin contraction. And then you have to find how the effectin is regulated by the stiffness or extracellular force. Okay? But not from the canonical classical pathway. So this is a classical pathway. So if we prove this is working, this is not working, which means this myosin light chain phosphatase can be activated by another mechanism, not through ROCK kinase, but through MHCK phosphatase or MHCK kinase or MHC phosphatase. Okay? So step by step, you can prove your concept. And then you have to depict finally the final result in one schematic images, how they are linking together. Okay? So maybe in this cell Nature paper, they didn't depict this kind of mechanical transduction pathway, but they are already known this pathway. Okay? So when you see the certain paper, and then in the last figure, they always showing these schematic images, how the mechanical transduction from the ECM or extracellular force or some other things can affect to your cell, you have to ask yourself, this is really, I have to prove another way? So I'm gonna share one thing. So how you can design your experiment using this mechanical transduction pathway? So maybe you can utilize mechanical or matrix factor like stiffness, some patterning, substrate different, nanoparticle, microparticle treatment, or any kind of can be involved, something ions. So I suggest mechanical transduction pathway study flow like this. First, check the actin, DAPI, ICC, 1 to 24 hour overtime, like 1 for 12, 24, or 12, 24 hour, it's up to you, firstly. And then see how the actin and DAPI change. DAPI for evaluating euchromatin, heterochromatin structure in a low cost way, okay? Euchromatin means more less color of DAPI. Heterochromatin is more dense color. Okay? When your DAPI stain certain less than control, which means cell are somehow open the chromatin for doing something. This is called euchromatin open, OO. Heterochromatin, I hate you, close, and then cell are deactivated. And why the role of actin? When actin is less formed or more formed. More formed means this kind of mechanical transduction pathway in many chains can be involved. Less formed means they are more migrating or they are not spreading that much. Or, and then from this actin DAPI structure, you can approximately evaluate the cell area as well. And then nucleus area. So from this number one study, you can make one or two figure. Actin spreading area, nucleus 2D projection area, and then when you do 3D, 3D volume from the actin, or nucleus volume, or euchromatin, heterochromatin structure possibly, and then low kinase, this kind of MHC phosphatase or effectin can be involved or not involved. It's first one. And then next, you can check the gene expression level, qPCR, for your target cellular signaling or cellular behavior. Like in case of macrophage, you can check M1 and M2 marker. In case of some MSC, you can check some secretome or some differentiation related gene. Okay? Or in your case, it's more easy to check by the Western blot, it's okay. And then you can check the protein level, their cellular, how they are changing. Okay? And then either check by the gene or protein level. And then at the same time, you can check cellular final behavior like cell adhesion, migration, proliferation, differentiation. So maybe this number 2, 3, 4 can be combined. Or sometimes you can do number 4 first. Anyhow, in case of macrophage, you have to check their polarization. And then through this gene expression, protein, or their another cellular PA, you can see how they change their behavior. And then you can try to link how this actin, DAPI, deformation, formation can be involved in this cellular behavior. Okay? And then for proving how they behave, how they link, you can do RNA sequencing, ATAC sequencing, which chromatin is open, RNA sequencing, which transcriptome, which mRNA is highly expressed, ChIP-seq, what kind of histone protein are involved in your study. Number five. Number five actually is, if you want to study very heavily, deeply, you have to perform the number five. But you only want to know some from the classical mechanism pathway, and then after skip number five, you can do mechanism study, number six first, using our inhibitor. Okay, you see M1 polarization more on your substrate. M1 is more ICC stain and Western blot detected. The mechanism, you treat Y, BLEBI, LADE, or NSC to prove how your material can affect the final outcome. Final outcome means the final M1 polarization. Or in case of MSC differentiation, MSC differentiation. So when certain inhibitor working, which means they are involved. No working, they are not involved. Okay? And then, so you can do like number one, and one of the 2, 3, 4, and then some mechanism, and then you find, oh, I need to study deeply, and then you can try number five or so, sequencing. Because sequencing is expensive, so anyhow, for sending your sample for sequencing, you have to catch the idea from the number six mechanism study. And then, finally, in vivo study. Okay, actually this number 1 to 7 is based on your figure sequencing. Okay, figure sequencing is, it can be like this. Number one, cell behave like that. From the gene level, DNA can be transcript to gene, mRNA, okay? Gene should be transcript to mRNA level. So you check qPCR. mRNA level, translate to the protein. So protein. So euchromatin, heterochromatin is DNA decondensed, condensed, open and unopened. Actin is ECM. So from the cell component change, gene level change, protein level change, final behavior change. Okay? And then after showing that, how they occur. So from sequencing, you show some possible mechanism, and then for proving the sequencing data, you can do mechanism study and then some in vivo study. But in real study, how you will do, even though you have to show your figure like this sequencing in your paper, but in reality, I suggest like this. Yeah. Always first thing is you have to do it very quickly in initial time, because making a transaction not going on 1 week or 3 days. They always do 1 day or 2 day at least. Maximum is 1 day, 2 day. Okay? But in detail you can refer to the literature, but most of the time from the initial cell binding and then cell sensing is occur within 24 hours. So try to see 24 hours always. So number one, some staining, actin followed and not be staining. And then quantify. And then if you see some change, next. Number four, cellular pH. Adhesion, migration, preparation, differentiation, anything is change. And then when this change also can be combined to protein or gene expression level, IHC, Western blot, QPCR. And then cost expensive, so we can perform in-immune study first. Okay? And then while you are doing in-immune study, you have to check when you inhibit some mechanism, this gene level protein or cellular pH change or not. You have to check both of them, right? When you do inhibitor study, inhibit something and then check the previous finding. Finding means behavior, Western and protein level or gene level. And then after finding certain flow, oh, maybe this kind of pathway can be involved in my material or in my mechanical study, and you can send your sample for certain sequencing, RNA, ATAC, epigenetic sequencing, and chip sequencing. And then, while you are sending your sequencing, you can perform in vivo study. This stage. Actually, this is time flow, but while you are doing this number three or two, protein or QPCR level, maybe you already got some answer. Okay? Because you already got the answer, so in that case, you have to perform the animal study here. And then, while you are doing this sequencing data, animal study is done, and then you can correlate each other. And then, right after sequencing data coming and analyzing, you can publish your paper. But during this time, this is a perfect scenario, but as your first assumption, maybe this is the best way, but somehow from this in vivo study result, or for active sequencing result, some can be mixed, or a certain mechanism is anotherly, you can find it, and then you have to do one more time. But maybe, so for doing this, very important thing is that you should not all kind of experiment in each step, which means actin.p, euchromatic, chromatic staining. Just when you see some change, and then you have to quickly go next, not fully devoted yourself for number one, okay? Because the key point is you have to check key result one by one, 1, 4, 3, 2, 6, and then you quickly you have to go this way, but not fully. But after finding some possible answer or certain mechanism, and then while you are rearranging your figure, you can fill up the another part, okay? So when you want to accelerate your mechanical study, important thing is that you have to do key study first. Number one, okay, nuclear decondense, it's enough. And then how this decondense is involved in your macrophage polarization, check. M1 is enhanced. Okay, M1 is enhanced. How this material can enhance M1? Inhibition study. Oh, BLEBI is working, LADE working, why not working? Okay. Done. And then maybe I prove this concept, I put my sample to subcutaneous during the time. And then you are doing, before you are sequencing, you can find another many literature how they explain this phenomenon. Similar paper, you can find it. But from that point, I mean, you can select RNA sequencing, ATAC-seq, ChIP-seq, which kind of sequencing you are doing. And then finally, while you are sending your sample, you fill all kind of experiment. in detail, and then finish. So why this? So as you know, transcription happen 80 BP per second, transcription level, base pair. Then mRNA must be proceed, export to cytosol, translation initiation must occur. And then translation, the speed is 20 amino acid per sequence, per sec. So the thing I want to tell you that if you analyze something, mRNA also needs some time. 80 base pair per second. In mRNA protein translation, 20 amino acid per second. So for mRNA splicing, normally people say 5 to 10 minutes on average, depending on mRNA size. But while you are treat something, 5 or 10 minutes, mRNA can be spliced and then to the cytoplasm, they are exported. And another 5 to 10 minutes later, mRNA should be translated. But this is an mRNA and protein level from newly synthesized mRNA protein. But your mechanism somehow very sudden. Sudden means they don't much time to make new protein. And then what happened? They are using phosphorylation, polymerization, or non-polymerization. Phosphorylation is very easy and sudden way to turn on and turn off. Even they don't change any protein volume or amount. Okay? But in case of monomer or polymerization of actin, why monomer or actin polymerization? They always is monomer, but very suddenly, when they need it, they collect it for making actin polymerization. So this is why YAPTAZ is very important. YAPTAZ, even though they didn't change the total protein level, from the phosphorylation or non-phosphorylation, they can go inside or go outside. So that is why they are utilized as a mechanical sensor. Because mechanical sensing, very fast, so they don't have much time to make new protein. So under this this kind of concept, you have to think about how you utilize this concept for your experiment, and then how you efficiently perform your experiment. Okay. So here, this is some paper of the advanced science. Maybe you can read this paper in detail, this last slide. So maybe when I see this paper, I feel like they perform do like this. Number one, they also check titanium. They are making different substrate of titanium as a honeycomb structure. They few analyze it. Making titanium, different structure, is okay. Number two, they check macrophage immune response. Just few key experiments, not all. M1 staining, M2 staining is enough. M1 increasing, M2 decreasing. Okay. And then also, they want to link this macrophage and then MSC differentiation. Also, they check MSC differentiation very quickly, just one or two experiments. 7-day ALP, 14-day ARS is enough. Not qPCR, not ICCO, as initially. And then, when they check, maybe this kind of macrophage polarization, M2, for example, MSC is more osteogenic, confirmed by in vitro. And then they perform in vivo study in this stage. They implant their material to tibia, the real experiment. And then while the in vivo is performed, they check the mechanism study. Actually, in vivo study, not much involved in mechanism, right? This is some final outcome. So you don't need to put inhibitor study in vivo. But sometimes you can add, but most of the time, you don't need. And then while the in vivo study is done for 6 months, you can do mechanism study using inhibitor or some other inhibitor. And then while the inhibitor study, you have to check figure 2 and 3, some missing part you can attach. And then when you do INHBE the study, also you have to do qPCR Western blot again, because you have to do it at the same time, right? And then you can find something mechanism from this up to here, and then figure five, you have to do some bioinformatic ATAC sequencing or other sequencing. In sequencing, maybe sometime you can add another inhibitor study, like epigenetic inhibitor or any kind of inhibitor also you can be involved. It's an option. So one certain inhibitor group also you can add. And then, while ending this animal study, you can finish and summon your people. This is some smart way how to perform the experiment. But sometime, maybe you can be struggle in the between here, but theoretically, this is a good way to make this figure. So yeah, this is the end of this lecture. Thank you. Any question? Okay.